Hello students, in this module I am going to discuss about schizophrenia. The objectives of this module are to have an overview of schizophrenia, to look into the causal factors of schizophrenia, to look into the symptoms of schizophrenia and its overall management. Now, what is schizophrenia? Schizophrenia is a severe mental disorder and it affects individuals from various backgrounds. This condition is characterized by wide range of cognitive and behavioral impairments. A significant phenomenon typical of schizophrenia is psychosis, which is defined as loss of contact with reality. Now, let's look into the prevalence and onset of schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is one of the major contributors to the global burden of disease. And to reduce this burden, we require prevalence rates. It is one among top 10 leading causes of disability across the world, resulting in huge economic as well as social costs. The incidence, that is the number of newly diagnosed cases yearly, is around 1.5 per 10,000 people. Now, evidence indicates sex differences in schizophrenia. And women tend to be diagnosed later in life as compared to their counterparts. Now, studies have indicated that the prognosis is worse among men. The reduction in lifespan is around 17.5 years for women with schizoaffective disorder. Schizophrenia has both positive as well as negative symptoms. Now, what are positive symptoms? Positive symptoms reflect distortion in normal range of behaviors and experience, such as delusions and hallucinations. On the other hand, negative symptoms reflect absence or deficit of behaviors that are normally present. Most individuals with this condition exhibit positive as well as negative symptoms. However, presence of negative symptoms is not a good indication for the individual's futuristic outcome. Now, let's look into what is hallucination. Hallucination is a sensory experience in the absence of external perceptual stimulus, and hallucinations can occur in any sensory modality, for example, auditory, visual, olfactory, tactile or gustatory. However, auditory hallucinations are more common. Now, what is delusion? Delusion is an erroneous belief maintained despite clear contradictory evidence. In schizophrenia, certain types of delusions are quite characteristic, and prominent among these are thought control, where one's thoughts, actions or feelings are being controlled by external agents; thought broadcasting, where one believes that one's personal thoughts are being broadcast to others. Now, thought insertion, where one believes that his or her thoughts are being inserted into their mind by some external agency; thought withdrawal, where one's thoughts has been dropped by an external agency. Now, let's look at what is persecutory delusions. Persecutory delusions are those in which affected individuals believe that they are being persecuted. Now, grandiose delusions. Individual believes that he or she has exceptional abilities, wealth, fame, or are omnipotent. Delusions of reference, where a neutral event is thought to have special as well as personal meaning, such as a TV or television program. Sometimes delusions become complex system, not just isolated beliefs. Disorganized speech is another prominent symptom of schizophrenia. In certain cases, totally new or made up words appear in the patient's or individual's speech, known as neologisms. Now, disorganized behavior is another prominent symptom of schizophrenia. It is noticeable in the areas of daily functioning, such as social relations, self-care or work. Catatonia is another striking behavioral disturbance noticed in patients with schizophrenia, in which there is absence of all movement as well as speech and be in a catatonic stupor. Now, coming to the negative symptoms, what are negative symptoms? Negative symptoms are affective flattening, alogia, which is very little speech, and avolition, which is inability to initiate and persevere in goal-directed behavior. Now, let's look into the DSM-5 criteria for schizophrenia. Criteria A, two or more of the following each present for a significant portion of time during a 1 month period or less if successfully treated, at least one of these must be present. One is delusions, second is hallucinations, third is disorganized speech, that is frequent derailment or incoherence. Fourth is grossly disorganized or catatonic behavior. Fifth is negative symptoms, that is diminished emotional expression or avolition. Now, criteria B. For a significant portion of time since the onset of disturbance, level of functioning in one or more major areas such as work, interpersonal relationships or self-care is markedly below the level achieved prior to the onset, or where the onset is in childhood or adolescence, there is a failure to achieve expected level of interpersonal, academic or occupational functioning. Criteria C, continuous signs of the disturbance persist for at least 6 months. The 6 month period must include at least 1 month of symptoms or less if successfully treated that meet criteria A, that is active phase symptoms, and may include periods of prodromal or residual symptoms. During these prodromal or residual periods, the signs of the disturbances may be manifested by only negative symptoms or by two or more symptoms listed in criterion A present in an attenuated form, that is odd beliefs, unusual perceptual experiences. Criteria D. Schizoaffective disorder and depressive or bipolar disorder with psychotic features have been ruled out because either no major depressive or maniac episodes have occurred concurrently with the active phase symptoms, or if mood episodes have occurred during active phase symptoms, they have been present for a minority of the total duration of the active and residual period of the illness. Criteria E. The disturbance is not attributable to the physiological effects of a substance, that is a drug of abuse, a medication or another medical condition. Criteria F. If there is a history of autism spectrum disorder or a communication disorder of childhood onset, the additional diagnosis of schizophrenia is made only if prominent delusions or hallucinations in addition to the other required symptoms of schizophrenia are also present for at least 1 month or less if successfully treated. These are broadly similar to DSM-4-TR and to the criteria given in ICD-10. Now, let's look into ICD-10. ICD-10, it is International Statistical Classification of Diseases and Related Health Problems. It lists 7 subclassifications of schizophrenia, namely paranoid, hebephrenic, catatonic, undifferentiated, post-schizophrenic depression, residual, simple, and other. Now, let's talk about subtypes of schizophrenia. DSM-4-TR recognized several subtypes of schizophrenia, and most clinically meaningful are paranoid schizophrenia, disorganized schizophrenia, characterized by disorganized behavior and speech and flat or inappropriate affect, and catatonic schizophrenia, which is characterized by pronounced motor signs reflecting greater excitement or stupor. These subtypes of schizophrenia are no longer included in DSM-5, as research utilizing the subtyping approach did not reveal major insights into the etiology or treatment of the disorder. Now, let's see what are the other psychotic disorders. Schizoaffective disorder, it's a diagnostic category recognized by DSM-5. The features of this disorder include that of both schizophrenia and severe mood disorder. Now, let's see what is the DSM-5 criteria for schizoaffective disorder. Criteria A, an uninterrupted period of illness during which there is a major mood episode, major depressive or maniac, concurrent with criterion A of schizophrenia. Criteria B, delusions or hallucinations for 2 or more weeks in the absence of a major mood episode, depressive or maniac, during the lifetime duration of the illness. Criteria C, symptoms that meet criteria for a major mood episode are present for the majority of the total duration of the active and residual portions of the illness. Criteria D, the disturbance is not attributable to the effects of a substance, that is, a drug of abuse, a medication or another medical condition. The second category under other psychotic disorders is schizophreniform disorder. It is another category reserved for schizophrenia, like psychosis, that last at least a month but do not last for 6 months. Now, let's look into DSM-5 criteria for this disorder. Criteria A, 2 or more of the following each present for a significant portion of time during 1 month period or less if successfully treated. At least one of these must be: 1, delusions; 2, hallucinations; 3, disorganized speech; 4, grossly disorganized or catatonic behavior; 5, negative symptoms, that is, diminished emotional expression or avolition. Criteria B, an episode of the disorder lasts at least 1 month but less than 6 months. When the diagnosis must be made without waiting for recovery, it should be qualified as provisional. Criteria C, schizoaffective disorder and depressive or bipolar disorder with psychotic features have been ruled out because either no major depressive or maniac episodes have occurred concurrently with the active phase symptoms, or if mood episodes have occurred during active phase symptoms, they have been present for a minority of the total duration of the active and residual periods of the illness. Coming to criteria D, the disturbance is not attributable to the physiological effects of a substance, that is, a drug of abuse, a medication or another medical condition. Now, there is a disorder called schizotypal personality disorder, which is characterized by excessive introversion, pervasive social interpersonal deficits, cognitive and perceptual distortions and eccentricities in communication and behavior. Now, other psychotic disorders also include delusional disorder, which is characterized by delusions or false beliefs, and brief psychotic disorders characterized by sudden onset of disorganized speech, psychotic symptoms or catatonic behavior. Now, DSM-5 has criteria for each of these disorders. Now, we have been talking about schizophrenia, its symptoms and DSM-5 criteria. Research has shown that schizophrenia is a result of complex interplay between genetic and environmental factors. Now, we have been talking about schizophrenia. What is schizophrenia? Its symptoms and DSM-5 criteria for schizophrenia. Now, let's look into what are the risk factors associated with schizophrenia. What are the causes of schizophrenia? Research have shown that schizophrenia is a result of complex interplay between genetic as well as environmental factors. Now, let's see what are the genetic factors and biological factors. The lifetime risk of schizophrenia is about 6.5% in first degree relatives of individuals with this condition and below 1% in general population. Schizophrenia rates for identical twins were consistently found to be much higher as compared to ordinary siblings or fraternal twins. The lifetime risk raises to more than 40% for monozygotic twins of affected people. Growing evidence suggests that prenatal exposure to viral infections play a significant role in the etiology of schizophrenia. A study revealed a heightened risk of schizophrenia in individuals who were in second trimester of fetal development during influenza pandemic. Research has shown that the rate of schizophrenia was higher among Rh incompatible groups as compared to Rh compatible group, including male subjects. Another study has revealed that rhesus D incompatibility heightens risk of schizophrenia. Complications during pregnancy and delivery reveal susceptibility for schizophrenia. Parental age is another significant factor that was found to be associated with schizophrenia. Studies have revealed that the risk of schizophrenia reaches 3 times normal levels among offspring of men aged 50 or above. On the other hand, increase in risk of this condition in the offspring of men with younger age has been observed. Maternal depression during pregnancy is associated with elevated rates of schizophrenia. There is also research evidence indicating that micronutrient deficiencies such as low homocysteine as well as vitamin D increase the incidence of this condition. Studies have revealed an association between early motor developmental milestones and risk of adult schizophrenia. Delayed walking, standing unsupported, and sitting were found to be related to adult onset schizophrenia. Research has also indicated that a lower IQ is an independent risk factor for developing schizophrenia at a later point. Impaired functioning of frontal lobes while performing cognitive tasks was found in individuals at high risk for developing this condition. The dopamine hypothesis of schizophrenia assumes that the symptoms of schizophrenia like psychosis are due to a disturbed and hyperactive dopaminergic signal transduction. Now, we have been seeing genetic and biological factors associated with schizophrenia. Now, let's talk about psychosocial and cultural aspects related to schizophrenia. Research indicates that the prevalence of schizophrenia is higher in urban areas as compared to rural areas. Living in urban environment is considered as one of the significant factors in developing this condition. Substance abuse is indicated as one of the factors in etiology of schizophrenia. Up to 50% of individuals with schizophrenia show either alcohol or drug dependence, and more than 70% are nicotine dependent. Diathesis stress model attempts to explain any disorder as an outcome of interaction between biological or genetic traits and environmental influences. Now, migration has been associated with schizophrenia. Migration has also been associated with schizophrenia. A meta-analysis revealed a higher risk for schizophrenia in first and second generation migrants. Now, we have seen the genetic factors, biological factors, and psychosocial factors and cultural factors in the etiology of schizophrenia. Now, let's look at the treatment of schizophrenia. pharmacological approaches to treatment of schizophrenia has shown positive results. Medications are largely used in the treatment and management of schizophrenia. Evidence have demonstrated the efficacy and effectiveness of antipsychotic medications. Now let's talk about psychosocial approaches to treatment of schizophrenia. Psychosocial approaches are of value. Some of these approaches are typically used in conjunction with medications. Psychosocial approaches aim to promote functional recovery among patients. Various psychosocial treatments are available for schizophrenia, and some of them are cognitive behavioral therapy, social skills training, cognitive remediation, assertive community treatment, and psychoeducation. Individuals with schizophrenia often have trouble forming friendships, living independently, or finding and keeping a job. In this context, social skills training is helpful to the patients in acquiring the necessary skills that are required to function better on a day-to-day basis. Results of research studies utilizing CBT, that is cognitive behavior therapy, have shown its positive benefits in reducing positive symptoms. However, data suggests that CBT has not been found helpful in reduction of negative symptoms and severe psychotic symptoms. Evidence also suggests that group delivery of CBT may be cost effective. Research has revealed that psychoeducation for schizophrenia containing individual behavioral therapy, communication skills training, self-assertive and problem-solving training, as well as family therapy could produce a significant decrease in rehospitalization rates and shortened hospital stays. Research studies have shown that individuals do better clinically and relapse rates are lower when families receive family treatment. Cognitive remediation training. This is another approach that helps individuals with schizophrenia improve their attention, memory, executive functioning skills, and these approaches work best when they are coupled with existing rehabilitation strategies and offered to individuals who are already clinically stable. Other traditional approaches to psychosocial interventions, such as psychodynamic psychotherapy, client-centered, supportive and insight-oriented psychotherapy, behavioral modification techniques such as token economy, were believed to be effective, however, are lacking empirical and systematic outcome studies to support each as evidence-based intervention for schizophrenia. Now, let's conclude this session. To conclude this session, schizophrenia is one of the most disabling mental disorders. It is characterized by distortions in perception, thinking, emotions, language, and behavior. It is associated with considerable amount of disability and affects various dimensions of individual's life. The risk factors involved in the development of schizophrenia range from genes to environmental factors. Overall management of schizophrenia is possible with medication and psychosocial support. Thank you.